أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ومن كفر فلا يحزنك كفره، إلينا مرجعهم فننبئهم بما عملوا، إن الله عليم بذات الصدور. نمتعهم قليلا ثم نضطرهم إلى عذاب غليظ. ولئن سألتهم من خلق السماوات والأرض ليقولن الله، قل الحمد لله، بل أكثرهم لا يعلمون. لله ما في السماوات والأرض، إن الله هو الغني الحميد. صدق الله العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Respected elders and brothers, our beloved viewers at home, alhamdulillah, today we are sitting for the third time to go over Surah Luqman. Hopefully, inshallah, we finish today. We are up to verse number 23. Where Allah says, وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَلَا يَحْزُنْكَ كُفْرُهُ إِلَيْنَا مَرْجِعُهُمْ فَنُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. So right before this verse, Allah Azza wa Jal encouraged the believers, and he said that whoever believes and he submits to Allah and he does good deeds, then he has held on to the most trustworthy handhold, which was right here. فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى. Now in this verse, Allah Azza wa Jalla reminded the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and all the other Sahaba that not to worry about the situation and the circumstances and the power and the might and the influence the kuffar might have now over them and over the territory where they live in. So Allah says about them, وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَلَا يَحْزُنْكَ كُفْرُ. Whoever disbelieves, whoever doesn't believe in Allah Azza wa Jalla, don't let his kufr, don't let his disbelief sadden you and discourage you and think that they have so much power, so much might, so much resource, and so on and so forth. How come we believers, we don't have this, et cetera, et cetera. So as for this world, we all know that this world can be given to anybody, whether you're Muslim or Kafir, it does not matter. There's a system placed for this world. Whoever makes effort, they will get results for this world, and it will end at this world, it will terminate here. So you see the kuffar with their glamorous lifestyle and the power and might they have, don't let that discourage you or weaken your belief. That is the system of this world, and that's how things will run. إِلَيْنَا مَرْجِعُهُمْ فَنُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا. And at the end of the day, Allah says, their return is to us, and we will inform them of what they have done, the work that they have done, whether it's in politics or government or power, influence, whatever they have done, whether it will hold any value and weight and significance to Allah or not, Allah Azza wa Jalla will inform them of that. And of course, a person who dies with kufr, none of their actions will be of any benefit to them. Inna Allah alimun bi dhati sudur. But at the same time, do not go speculating and inspecting people and say, this guy's a kafir, this guy's not, this guy's half Muslim. None of that stuff is your job. All of that is in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Even if someone apparently dies on kufr, we should not make a determination, a decision that this guy died on kufr and he'll be in Jahannam forever. No, you don't know in what state that person might have died. You leave that to Allah Azza wa Jal. He is the one who is all knowledgeable about the affairs of the chest, about the affairs of the hearts, what's in the hearts of people. نُمَتِّعُهُمْ قَلِيلًا ثُمَّ نَضْطَرُّهُمْ إِلَىٰ عَذَابٍ غَلِيظٍ. نُمَتِّعُهُمْ قَلِيلًا. We give them some respite, some enjoyment, some time, some brief enjoyment in this world. نُمَتِّعُهُمْ قَلِيلًا. And then نُثُمَّ نَضْطَرُّهُمْ إِلَىٰ عَذَابٍ غَلِيظٍ. Then we will force them to a grave, serious, massive punishment. It's just enjoyment in this world, right? There's a conversation between Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhu, when Abu Bakr, he gave one of the, what do you call that, the ghanima and the spoils of war He gave to everyone equally, regardless of when they became Muslim or how much contribution they had towards Islam. So he asked Umar radiallahu anhu, what do you think? I wanted to consult with you about this thing, that I give everyone the same share of the spoils of war. What do you think about that? So Umar radiallahu anhu said, Ya Abu Bakr, Ya Khalifat Rasulullah, O successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I think that whoever accepted Islam first, they should get a bigger share. And those who accepted Islam later, they should have a smaller share. He said, I will not make the one who fought the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam same as the one who fought with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So those who accepted Islam first, they fought with the Prophet, they supported him, and they were ready to give up their lives for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those who came later, in the beginning part of Islam, they were fighting against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he says that I want to honor those, I would honor those people who accepted Islam first by giving them a bigger share. So Abu Bakr said, I understand where you're coming from, but this dunya, innama hadhi dunya bala, this world is not a final destination that you have to start allocating different amount of share for different people. It's not a big deal. This dunya is just a balab. It's supposed to get you to the next point. It's just a transition. It doesn't matter about the share. It's not a big deal. I wanted to give them everyone equal share because they all fought in this war equally. So the point is that he said, it doesn't matter how much you get here, how much you don't get here. This is not your final destination, right? Let's say you get on a flight for 20 hours and you lay over somewhere and you start complaining about, you know, the food in that airport, the temperature in there and this and that. And you go to the airport manager and you start to complain. Why are you going through all of that, Habibi? You're not going to be there for more than a couple of hours. You know, just deal with it. It's not a big deal. So this world, نُمَتِّرْهُمْ قَلِيلًا, we'll just give them brief enjoyment. You know, how short is this world, if we really think about it, right? We may think that we're going to live here for 50, 60, or whatever many years. At the end of the day, those many years are going to come to an end. And when you look back, as if those years didn't even exist, as if it was a dream, all those years that you lived your life. Right? When you're living through it, it might feel long and et cetera. But just 20 years down the line, you look back, 20 years was like a week. You don't even know how it passed by through the slips of your finger. Right? So it's very short compared to the thousands and thousands of years of the hereafter. I mean, if you pass by a graveyard, just look at the years those people have been dead for, you know, hundreds of years. No one knows them now. Similarly, it will be with us. After we die, how long are people going to remember us for? Like maybe a week, maybe 2 weeks, maybe if they're our close family, maybe a couple of months. And then life goes on. Life moves on. You were going to, as if you would be like a dream. Right? There's no existence of you anymore. And why are we shocked when people die? We all know people are going to die. If we have the knowledge, why are we shocked? Because we lived in this reality for so long that we stop thinking that there's another life to go to. So when someone amongst us dies, we are shocked to be brought back into the reality that we are heading towards. Right? So this world is like a mirage. It looks like it exists, but it doesn't really have any existence. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. And for this mushrikun, this kufar, right, they are so boastful and they try to use so much logic about the hereafter and say, how are we going to be resurrected? It doesn't make sense. Just the other day, I was listening to this podcast or a conversation between a believing person and an atheist. He's a very big scientist. He's the director of a natural history museum in Manhattan. He's an astrophysicist, Harvard graduate, and he's an atheist, you know. So the host asked him that, where did we all come from? So he said that, you know, we came from a Big Bang and everything started in the Big Bang. And he tries to prove it that, you know, the universe is moving, everything is moving. It just shows that it started from that point, and since then it's just been moving. So the host asked him that, what was before the Big Bang? And then he just goes silent. Like, oh, he says, I have some people looking into that, you know. So they are so, dependent or enslaved to their mind that if something goes against their logic, common sense, they're just not going to accept it. And there's no element of faith in believing in the existence of a divine being and someone, a greater supreme being who created everything for a purpose. So these people, not the atheists, but the mushrikun of Makkah, if you ask them, if you ask them who created the heavens and the earth, they will say, Allah. Allah created the heavens and earth, and He's the one who created all of this by Himself. Right? So we might have mentioned this before, that the mushrikun of Makkah, they didn't have a problem in Tawhid al-Rububiyyah, in unifying Allah as the sole creator of everything. Right? But their problem was in Tawhid al-Uluhiyyah, giving the worship only to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Their problem was that they would worship Allah and they would worship other things with Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's where the problem came. And that's a big problem, right? Yes, we believe in Allah Azza wa Jalla. We have to make our worship solely to Allah. Right? No form of praise that belongs to Allah should be given to anyone else. No thing that we asked only to Allah should be asked to anyone else, right? So a lot of times we may not realize, but in a place where we're supposed to call Allah Azza wa Jal, if you call someone else instead of Allah Azza wa Jal, we might not think it's a big deal, but you know, we are putting someone in the place where we're supposed to be calling Allah Azza wa Jal for help. Like, for example, if you fall into a problem, you say, oh my God, or Ya Allah, what a problem I just fell into. So instead of that, what if you say something else, right? When you fall into a problem, you're indirectly asking for help because of the problem that you're in. Now, some people who have other beliefs, they might say, Ya Ali, right? When they're in a problem. So, of course, that's wrong, right? Similarly, we should avoid things like that. Sometimes we might say, Ya Allah, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Allah, and oh Rasulullah. When you're in a problem and you're in trouble, you're supposed to call only Allah, not the Prophet with Allah. Similarly, some people, when they fall in a problem, they say Jesus. They're Muslims, right? But they say Jesus because it's becoming so common. So these things we should be careful. All worship that belongs only to Allah Azza wa Jalla, all forms of worship, whether it's verbal, physical, they all belong to Allah alone. And Allah tells the Prophet, لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ. That, O Prophet, if you do shirk, then all of your amal will be destroyed. You think the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you know, would need to remind it about not doing shirk? He is the Prophet of Allah. Of course, is a warning that even if the Prophet does it, which means us, it's even more important for us that we stay away from all forms of shirk in association with Allah Azza wa Jal. قُلِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. Say, all praise belongs to Allah. بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Say, all praise belongs to Allah, meaning what? That even they will say Allah created everything. But it's just the customs that they have grown up with. They just follow that. Their forefathers worshipped something else, so they're going to do the same thing. You know, it's very powerful. The environment that we grew up in, you know, we all try to belong somewhere. You know, we're scared of going out of the circle and not going with the flow with everyone else. This is my family there. This is where I belong. This is what everybody did. I'm just going to do the same thing. You know, I lived in a country where they treated expats and people who came from other countries who work for them as needy beggars who need them. And that person, he was an educated person, but he said, you know, I'm going to come to you clean. I'm going to be honest. You know, we were brought up like this. We were brought up thinking that these people need us. They're in need of us. They're poor. They're hungry, and we provide for them. And so, you know, even though, like, he's such an educated person, and he knows this is wrong, but he says, sometimes I fall into it too, because that's how I was brought up. So they, even though they know Allah is alone and He's the one who created everything, they worship other things along with Allah, so because that's what their family did, you know, that's what their society did. they know that a rock cannot answer their prayer and their request, but they do it because everybody did. But أكثرهم لا يعلمون, but most of them do not know. They don't have true knowledge. They just follow blindly, right? They just follow blindly whatever their forefathers and their ancestors did. And so even they, with their attestment, Allah says, لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, that to Allah belongs whatever is in the heavens and the earth. No one can deny that, even these mushrikun. إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْغَنِيِّ الْحَمِيدِ, Allah is al-ghani, He is independent, He is not in need of any other deities, any other gods. And He is al-hamid, He is praiseworthy, He's always been praiseworthy. The next verse, some mushrikun came to the Prophet ﷺ and they were saying that if you, whatever is Muhammad is saying, the Quran is reciting and all this surah he brings and stuff like that, he says, Sayanqadir, these things will come to an end one day. He will run out of things and he won't have anything else to say. May Allah Azza reveal this verse. Then if every tree, whatever tree is on earth, if it was made into pens, aqlam, والبحر يمده, and all the trees remaining into inks, and all the, what do you call it, all the oceans were turned into inks. And after that, seven more oceans were to be brought. And this seven doesn't really mean seven exactly. Seven in the Arab language is used for many. And many more oceans were brought after that as ink, and you start writing the kalimat of Allah, the words of Allah, the speech of Allah, the praise of Allah, ma nafidat kalimat Allah, the words of Allah, the speech of Allah, the praise of Allah will not come to an end, will never come to an end. In Allah azizun hakim, Allah is aziz, He is mighty, and Allah is hakim, He is wise. And so some of the things that may trigger the mushrikun to think that Allah has other gods with him, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, and other helpers and things like that, right? They said that Allah created everything, but one of the reasons why they may worship others with Allah is because they think that it's too much to handle all the universe and the everything that's going on. It's too much to handle for Allah, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, right? So then Allah answers to this accusation and objection. Allah says, مَا خَلْقُكُمْ وَلَا بَعَثُكُمْ إِلَّا كَنَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ, your creation and your resurrection is as if it's a single soul maintaining and feeding and providing and resurrecting and bringing to life billions and billions of people, humans and animals and everything else. It's as if like taking care, or not taking care, but creating and sustaining nafsin wahida, one single soul for Allah Azza wa Jalla. You can't compare a human being's ability to the abilities of Allah Azza wa Jalla. That is so, you know, it's foolish to think like that, to compare Allah Azza wa Jalla to human beings. You think you might need sleep and you might need things like that. You can't compare God to stuff like that. And mythology, a lot of mythologies, they compare, human beings to God, Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Allah is sami'un basirun, Allah is hearing, Allah is seeing. Alam tara anna Allah, don't you see that Allah Azza wa Jalla, He is the one, يُلِجُ اللَّيْلَ فِي النَّهَارِ وَيُلِجُ النَّهَارَ فِي اللَّيْلِ, He causes the night to enter the day and causes the day to enter the night. وَسَخَّرَ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرِ, and He has subjected, He has put into service for you the sun and the moon. كُلٌّ يَجْرِي إِلَى أَجْلٍ مُسَمَّى, they all run in their orbit for a specified term. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ, and Allah is all acquainted, all aware, all knowing of all that you do. So once again, right, you don't have to look too far and think too much about the creation of, about the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jalla and his existence, right? You just have to look at the things that are around you, the earth and the moon and the sun, and how they are all working in a perfect fashion and manner. And how, you know, He has placed under your service the celestial bodies, the sun and the moon, and how the night and the day, they're perfectly synchronized with each other, right? But everything runs for a appointed time. They'll all come to an end, and Allah is all aware of all that you do. ذلك بأن الله هو الحق وأن ما يدعون من دونه الباطل وأن الله هو العلي الكبير. That is because Allah is the truth, al-haq, and that is because whatever they call besides Allah is al-batil, وأن الله هو العلي الكبير, and because Allah is al-ali, the most high, al-kabir, the grand. It means that Allah, He shows you signs so that you may know from them that He is the truth. He truly exists and is truly divine, and that all else besides Him is a falsehood. He has no need of anything else, but everything else is dependent on Allah, because everything in heaven and on earth is created by Him and is enslaved by Allah. None of them could move even an atom's weight except with His permission. If all the people of heaven and earth were to come together to create a fly, they would not be able to do so. Inshallah, we'll stop here for this week and continue from next week, inshallah. أَلَمْ تَرَى أَنَّ الْفُلْكَ تَجْرِي فِي الْبَحْرِ بِنِعْمَةِ اللَّهِ. And we will see how some of the things that are exclusively the knowledge of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and how in the hereafter no one will be able to avail, even a father and a son won't be able to avail one another. Allah Azza wa Jalla give us all the tawfiq to implement, learn, understand, and practice the Quran and bring it into our lives. Inshallah, so you stay safe and healthy. We will see each other next week if Allah Azza wa Jalla gives us life. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.